last time I finished the discussion of etale cohomology of diamonds, the abstract setup. And so let me some of the whole program that I'm trying to pursue somehow consists in some kind of three-step process. The first one has to understand the abstract theory of etale cohomology of diamonds. Which is something that I pursued. And this is what I've talked about in this written. then the next step is the study of the stack bungee that I will talk about today and sheaves on it. This is something that is work in progress with Laurent Fargues. And then once one has understood this, one can try to really go to things one is interested in. And so on the one hand, one can try to define on some local Langlands correspondence to study it. That's what I sketched out in the very first lecture. And one can also try to prove that this local Langlands correspondence is realized in the cohomology of some Rapoport-Zink spaces and generalizations. So. In fact, the formalism allows for Weil's generalizations of Rapoport-Zink spaces and.
And does it include proving that it is the same as the previously known local Langlands course?
It includes, for GLN, it includes proving that it's the same thing as the previously defined correspondence. The problem for other groups is that in the cohomology of a specific variety, you can't really see an L parameter. You can only see a map to some GLN. And so you can usually only detect the image of some symplectic parameter or whatever in GLN, which sometimes is enough to determine the parameter. But I mean, anyway. So that's the kind of picture. In the abstract to the whole series, I included talking about something here. I'm afraid I won't be able to really get there. And so I've needed three lectures here, and I will probably need three lectures to really discuss this. So I will spend the last two lectures talking about this part of the picture. Okay, so I want to talk about this bungee today. So for this, as was already done, I fixed G over QP a reductive group. And for some reason, it's actually better to be in some kind of geometric setup in the sense that one works over a fixed algebraically closed base field. And I want to fix this algebraically closed base field from the start. So. Characteristic P, for example, K. And My test category will from now on be the category of perfectoid spaces. Over this, which have a structure morphism to the adic spectrum of K. So the algebras will be K algebras. Okay, let's call this perf K. And also an important notation will be this field L, which is the fraction field of the ring of fit vectors. Okay. And so then Ban G will be the following thing. It will be a stack on the category of perfectoid spaces. So let's say, well, there are slightly different perspectives on what a stack is. Either it's a functor, fibered, and groupoids, or something like this. A category of fibered and groupoids, so let me pretend it was actually a functor to groupoids, which takes any, let's call the test schemes now S. It maps it to the groupoid of G torsors on something that's called XS. And I need to recall what XS is. So here XS is a relative Fargues-Fontaine curve. Usually said to be over S, but actually there is no map to S. So it's kind of a lie. which is the same thing as some other space YS divided out by the action of the Frobenius of S to the Z. Where YS is the space that I called last time like this, which doesn't make sense. But I find it an intuitive way to think about what this should be. It should be the product of my test space S with the kind of curve I'm considering, which is, I mean, the curve is some of this punctured formal disk of Z around P, meaning QP, spec QP. Or maybe I change to an algebraic closed space field. But it's essentially QP here, which is a small punctured disk. So I have this family of small punctured disks. And so I will give a precise definition in just a second, which has a Frobenius phi S, which is the Frobenius on S times the identity. And because this is a product with spy L, this thing should sit over the adic spectrum of L. So it's an analytic adic space, automatically analytic. And actually, I should have said somewhere, which I maybe didn't, is that sometimes I just write spar r, but really the spar needs two ingredients. And if I don't write the second ingredient, it always means that I put circ in.
So if you take Frobenius on S, S is what? Is a perfected algebra over K. Perfected space.
Right. Right.
So the Frobenius on it is like for schemes, it's if you want the map to spar K to be equivariant, you have to put not identity. How can you put identity?
Yes. But there are two kinds of Frobenius you could put on spar. Well, so that's the same thing as S times spa FP spa QP. And then it makes sense. Sorry. So there would be two. Well, on spa L, there's really only one Frobenius. Okay. Okay, so okay. So let me tell you two things about YS, what YS is. One thing I can tell you is that if I pass to the diamond, which I'm allowed if it's such an adic space there, it really is true that it is S times somewhere absolutely. So I'll keep the diamond. So as diamonds, this formula is true. And well, for a general space, it's slightly tricky to write down what it is, because you, I mean, so what you do is you define it for affinoid spaces, and then you glue. And you glue so that this formula stays true. If S is the adic spectrum of some R plus, then YS is the following thing. You take the adic spectrum of the bit vectors R plus, with the intuition that this is something like taking the product with ZP. But then you want to do a product with QP. So what you do is you remove the locus where P is 0. but you also, I mean, you get R by inverting a pseudo-uniformizer here. And you need to do the same thing here. So you also need to remove the locus where pi is equal to 0, where pi and R plus is a pseudo-uniformizer. And you check that this is independent of the choice.
So this is just for the usual case of Tate affinity.
Well, yes. Yes. Okay. Yes. Yes. Yeah, 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 yeah. I mean, I asked perfectoid in the sense I defined in the lecture. Okay. And so you see that this has a Frobenius, which is just a Frobenius on R plus phi s. It's induced from the Frobenius. Where R plus is some perfect ring. Okay, so it's an automorphism. And you check that this acts totally discontinuously. And so it makes sense to pass to the quotient. So some kind of picture of this is that you have here is a ZP direction and here's the S direction. And then maybe this divisor would be, or maybe let me put here something in the R plus direction. Then here somewhere you have the divisor where pi is 0 and the divisor where P is 0. And then you're looking at the remaining part here. And then the Frobenius is something which shifts everything in this direction. And then if you want to take the quotient, you can somehow take some annulus here. And then identify the outer ends to form some kind of torus.
So under which condition I can pass to a quotient in adic spaces? I think here it's totally discontinuous in a very strong sense.
It's totally discontinuous in the strongest possible sense. I mean, so I mean, the quotient map is really a local isomorphism. You have local sections and so on. Okay, so so one important warning is that there is no map from, well, not even from YS, but in particular not from XS to S, because this is a characteristic P, whereas this is a characteristic 0 of X spaces. But there is such a map of diamonds, yeah? And because diamonds determine topological spaces and etale sites, you also get a map on topological spaces and etale sites. So in this sense, it is over S, but only in some vague sense. Okay. What else do I want to say? I mean, also some slightly funny property of this curve is that, say, if S is some sparse CC plus, where C is algebraically closed, non-Archimedean field, then you can compute the global sections of the structure sheaf on this curve. And it's just QP. So usually, for a relative curve over S, you would expect that the global sections would have something to do with a field in some kind of usual coherent setup. But here, it's always QP. And this is very important for what's about to happen. So this is because phi invariants in the ring of Witt vectors.
So I think, I believe that Fargues-Fontaine defined such curves from, more generally, you can have any local field. So they use the Witt vector relative to some.
Right. I mean, so as I said, you can. In all, everything I'm saying, you can replace QP by any local non-Archimedean field. And then you just replace Witt vectors by the corresponding generalization. And I mean, essentially, everything goes through in the same way.
And so it's compatible with the finite extension.
Finite extension of QP or FP Lorentz series.
So in particular, in the equal characteristic case, you will have still characteristic.
Yeah, in the equal characteristic case, it's still characteristic P. And so in this case, there would actually be such a map there. So in this case, this would also be a valid formula. What's important is that there's a functor from isocrystals over K, which I recall are finite dimensional L vector spaces V plus phi linear isomorphism phi V from V to V towards vector bundles on XS. So why? So that's because vector bundles on YS, on XS, are the same thing as vector bundles on YS plus, I mean, the same as phi S equivariant vector bundles on YS. And you can take some V phi V and map it to V tensor over L with O YS and the Frobenius, which is a tensor product.
Bundles on YS trivial?
All the vector bundles on YS trivial. Well, not for general S. If S is a geometric point.
S is a spectrum of a maximally complete field, maybe.
Okay.
At least in the equal characteristic case, it has, it is false if it's not maximally complete, spherically complete.
So Laurent Fargues says that let's put ourselves in the equal characteristic case and assume that S is a geometric point. Then they are not usually trivial, so there are not examples where the bundles are not trivial, even for line bundles, I think. There is a thing about the Picard group of these things. Even for line bundles, they are not trivial. But it might be true if S is spherically complete. I mean, there's a theorem of Lazar, apparently. For general vector bundles or just line bundles?
Lazar for line bundles and Grison for any vector bundle.
Lazar for line bundles, Grison for any vector bundle. Okay. And so more generally, you get a functor from what's called G isocrystals, okay, which are just tensor functors, exact tensor functors from the category of representations of G towards isocrystals. Towards Bungee of S and yes. Okay. And so there's the following important theorem, which for GLN. The theorem of Fargues-Fontaine. And for general G, is a theorem of Fargues. And let me also mention that in the equal characteristic case, this was open for a while, but it's now also resolved. So this is one instance where the equal characteristic case is actually harder because reductive groups and positive characteristic are more difficult. This was recently solved by Johannes Anschütz. It says that if you have a geometric point, then actually it is true that G bundles over this geometric point are up to isomorphism classified by isocrystals, G isocrystals, bijection, with a set that Kottwitz denotes by B of G, which is just G isocrystals. So over a geometric point, you can completely classify these guys.
So this is just a bijection. So you have a map.
Right, so there's a functor, but it's not an equivalence of groupoids. And I will say to what extent it fails to be an equivalence of groupoids in a second. Yeah, so let me stress this. So this is S sets, not groupoids. (Clears throat) So in these last two lectures, I want to, on the one hand, discuss the case of a general group, but on the other hand, I want to give the example in the case of GL2 to make it a little more concrete. So I will start discussing this example of GL2. And so, say in some connected component, maybe here, you have O squared, which specializes to something called O of 1 plus O of minus 1. So there, the Picard group of this curve is given by the integers as a consequence of the theorem, for example. And I denote the corresponding line bundles by O of n as usual. And so you have this kind of specializations here. Then there are also vector bundles that are called O of a half. So this is not a line bundle. This is a rank 2 bundle. So in general, the simple guys are classified by rational numbers, as in the case of isocrystals. And I denote the simple guy of some slope by O of the slope. So this is rank 2. And this will specialize to O of 1 plus O. Will specialize to O of 2 plus O of minus 1, etc. And then here you have maybe O of minus a half, specializing to O plus O of minus 1, etc. And then here you have O of minus 1 squared, specializing to O plus O of minus 2. And so this looks roughly similar to the picture you see for the stack of G bundles on P1. So for P1, you also just have a discrete or countable set of points and some funny specialization relations.
More like elliptic curves, like for rational numbers, like geo classifications
and what. But for elliptic curves, I think you have moduli, right?
So
there's some philosophy that if there is any genus of the Fargues-Fontaine curve, it's somewhere between 0 and 1. So the picture you get is usually some mixture of the picture you get for P1 and what you get for an elliptic curve. OK, so let me tell you what remains true of this picture in general. The first thing is that you can classify the connected components of Bungee. They are in general given by what's called the algebraic fundamental group as defined by Voronoi. And then you take the co-invariance under the Galois group. Let me write Galois to not confuse this with the group. And here it takes pi 1 g of a QP bar. And every connected component has a unique semisimple. A unique semi-stable. So these correspond to these generic points there. Eh? This is in general, yeah.
And semi-stable is defined by
By some kind of idea about reduction theory. I mean, one way to say it is that if you push it out along the adjoint representation, that then it's a semi-stable vector bundle. actually, the theory of semi-stable vector bundles works as well as it does in characteristic zero, even in positive characteristic, where there are usually some subtleties that it's not completely functorial. For example, tensor products of semi-stable bundles need not be semi-stable. In general, it is true for this curve. So you don't get into this kind of trouble. In fact, okay, let's denote this functor here by. So these guys are usually called B, and let me denote the associated bundle by EB. Then the condition that this bundle is semi-stable is a condition that's known from the theory of G isocrystals. It's a condition known that as being basic in the sense of Kottwitz. And in this case, it's actually true that if S is a geometric point, then the automorphisms of EB are the same thing as the automorphisms of B. automorphisms of this exact tensor functor, if you want, which, on the other hand, are also known as a group J, usually called JB, but I kind of want to call it GB because it's just an inner form of G. GB is an inner form of G associated with B. It's essentially determined by this property. And so you see that the automorphisms, yeah, let me give you the example in a second. So usually this is called JB, but this makes it look more asymmetric than the relation really is. Often denoted JB. So for example, you have that the automorphisms of O squared are just GL2QP. And in fact, this remains true as you pass to some functors. So if I if this is a thing which sends any s to the automorphisms of O squared on XS, and this is a thing which I define for any topological space, then this is true. There's a continuous function from S into GL2QP. So it is not the algebraic group GL2. Or if you take the automorphisms of this bundle O of a half, what you get is D cross, where D over QP is a quaternion algebra. And so in this picture, you get something of two periodic picture, where on the even connected components, you get GL2, and on the odd connected components, you get D cross. On the other hand, if you pass to non-semi-stable guys, if you look at the automorphism group scheme, or group diamond, of some non-semi-stable guy, so say O plus O of 1, then the picture becomes more complicated. So what you have are diagonal automorphisms where you just act by a scalar on O of 1, which are the automorphisms of just the line bundle. There are no maps from O of 1 to O, as one would maybe expect. So you have a 0 here. But there are a lot of maps from O to O of 1. It has a lot of global sections. So here you have, well, here in the upper corner, you get the global sections of O of 1. And this is some open unit disk. So it's one dimensional. Whereas QP cross is just a profinite set, so this is something zero dimensional.
So how does QP cross act? How does that?
Well, just by multiplying by scalar on these.
No, on the A0 of O of 1.
Also just by, well, this multiplies and this divides.
But then you want it to be in the open unit disk, so if it is open unit disk.
Well, I mean, it's like, sorry, which open unit disk is it? It's really, it's the, you take, the open unit disk inside the perfectified GM, which is the disk of radius 1, open disk of radius 1 around the identity. And this is some kind of QP vector space object. Because well, because you're perfect, you can somehow take piece roots also. So on yeah. It's one of these Banach called mesh spaces. Okay, and so there's a general picture. So in general, so if P is not necessarily basic. What you have is the following, that you have, and maybe I should have used, well, these are, like, birds are not bigger either. What you have is the following. So you have the automorphisms of this bundle EB. And there's actually a projection to this GB of QP, which now is not an inner form of G, but an inner form of a Levy of G, at least if G is quasi-split. So for example, in this case, it would just be the trivial inner form of the diagonal torus. But then there's a kernel of this map. And the kernel, what is it? It's some kind of unipotent group diamond. Which is a successive extension of some Banach mesh spaces.
And what is ought to be? What is it not to be? That's over a point. How does
Sorry?
You said that you have a map of group weights, which is not de facto. So there should be a
right, so there's actually a splitting of this map, which is given by this functor. So you always have the automorphisms of this B, which, if you do it functorial, will give you this JB of QP underline. It always maps to the automorphisms of this guy. But actually, it's also a quotient because it's also parameterizing the connected components of this group scheme. So this is something connected here. And so.
Doesn't it also give you a splitting of the
Hadamard
infiltration?
Does it give
Z A splitting of the Hadamard infiltration, then it does become, I think, an equivalence of categories.
Right. So if you look at G bundles together with a splitting of their, so we can always define some Hadamard infiltration. If you fix a splitting of this and then look at automorphisms which respect the splitting, then this always, if I would put this on the left-hand side, then this would be true as groupoids, which somehow isolates the subspace here. It's the ones which fix some chosen splitting. Well, EB, somehow, if it comes from a B, then this EB has a chosen splitting, so it sits inside. Okay. Good. So that's roughly what this space looks like. And so the basic theorem, I mean, as everything, I will talk about this joint work with Laurent Fargues. Is that, first of all, this bun G is really is a stack. It's a V stack. So you can glue G bundles in the V topology. But then you can ask yourself whether it's some kind of Artin stack, which is true in the classical setup. So being an Artin stack should mean that there is some smooth map onto it from something which is itself smooth. And this is also true. So there's some cohomologically smooth diamond. Okay. There's a cohomologically smooth surjective map. X2 bungee. Sorry, maybe I shouldn't call this X. I mean, just something. I don't think I will use C a lot, so I can use C here. So you should think that bungee is a smooth Artin stack. And I said that there is some slight confusion still about the notion of dimensions. But these confusions should go away in the relevant case and should be of dimension zero. Okay? And
cohomologically smooth, you define it relative to something.
Right, so it's cohomologically smooth for all L. And so whenever I will say cohomologically smooth in this lecture, I will mean it's L cohomologically smooth for all L not equal to P. Okay, so this means that you can actually extend this formalism of this d at Well, actually, this theta can always extend to V stacks, small V stacks, just because it makes sense to talk about the V side of a V stack, just saying all V sheaves mapping to it. So you can talk about sheaves of lambda modules on that, and then you can still isolate this d-ad inside. So this is something you can always define. But you can also define a dualizing complex in there. The dualizing complex of Bungee. This makes sense. And both of these make sense. For the second, you need that the dualizing complex commutes with pullback under smooth maps, which was part of what I said last time. I actually don't really know explicitly how to describe the dualizing complex. I think it's an interesting question. But what I know is that d Bungee is locally equivalent to lambda and degree zero. So as you would expect if it's of dimension zero. But it's not globally. It's actually related to Hahn measures. So if you have, say, k, a subgroup of g of qp, compact open, then you can wonder what the global sections on point mod k of the dualizing complex of point mod k. are, and those are Hahn measures on k. And so if k is pro p, you can always choose such a guy. But sometimes, if L is a prime which divides the pro order of k, you might not be able to find such a guy. Good guy. Anyway. It's not really important what it is right now. OK, so you can make sense of this d-ad of this Bungee. And in particular, you can also make sense of your duality. So let me actually assume from now on that my coefficients are the ring of integers of some e modulo L to the Zn, where e over zql is a finite extension.
You said that there is no Hahn measure, but there is one. If you have a compact group, even
yeah, that's right.
Take one on the smaller subgroup and put on the translator the same thing. So what do you?
Yeah, maybe there is one. I would have to think about this again. I think, well, this is true. And then you can wonder whether there really is a global trivialization of this. I'm confused about something. Yeah. Right. Anyway, some of trivializing. Let's say it's not quite canonical. It might be that there is a global isomorphism. Sorry. OK, so let me assume from now on that we're in this situation, which is maybe the one of most interest. So in particular, lambda is finite. it's Gorenstein. It's also self-injective. Which will play a little bit of an implicit role in what I'm doing. So we have a Viehmann duality, which, I mean, it might not be a duality really, but you can take any f to this R hom f into the dualizing complex of Bungie. And the following definition will be critical. So I want to define a good class of sheaves of Bungie that satisfies some good finiteness properties. And this notion of constructibility from yesterday is not good. First of all, because the strata on Bungie are not constructible. And secondly, because I want these sheaves to have infinite dimensional stalks, because the stalks should be related to representations of these p-adic groups. And so I need a different condition. And I make the following. I say that f in d at x lambda is reflexive lambda. Sorry, yes. It's reflexive. If the natural map from F to its double dual is an isomorphism. The usual notion of reflexivity. So because d Bungie is actually trivial, you don't have to know what the cotangent, the dualizing thing is actually. So it's equivalent to say that it's equivalent to the R hom. Okay. And the claim is that this is exactly the right finiteness condition to put. And so first, let me say that more generally. Say working with diamonds, let's say Z over a fixed base S. Which would be spark K here. let's say that f in d at z lambda is reflexive if f maps to the double dual of f, where now the dual is defined to be the R hom into the p upper freak lambda, the p from z to s is a projection. And so why is the notion of a reflexive sheaf nice? It's because it's easy to prove that reflexive sheaves are stable under some operations.
So what were the conditions to define this p-adic?
Yeah, so let's say representable and locally spatial and dimmed is finite. Okay, so I shouldn't call this y and x because, well, I mean, these are now just abstract things and unrelated to the y's and the x's that appeared before. if you have a proper map and you have a reflexive sheaf upstairs, then the push forward is automatically reflexive. And in the other direction, for pullbacks, if you have a cohomologically, L-cohomologically smooth map, and you have a reflexive sheaf on the base, then the pullback is again reflexive. Okay, so this essentially will imply that reflexive sheaves are stable under the Heck operators. Oh, I should say that there's still a little bit of work to do. But it's the essential idea that you can reduce to Heck correspondences which are given by smooth kernels. And then the pulling back first preserves reflexivity. And then it's also a proper map. So push forward will again preserve reflexivity. And so it's a notion that's easily seen to be stable under the Heck operators. That's why it's a good notion.
It depends on the special property of the Heck correspondence.
Well, I mean, it depends on those properties that are somehow smooth, given by smooth proper maps. I can essentially completely prove this. So we always have the following identities. That the dual of RF Lower Shriek is RF Lower Star of the dual. So this is a duality on X, and this is a duality on Y. And also one for the shriek. So these are true on the full derived category. Well, assuming that F is good enough to even define what these functors are. I mean, it needs to be Well, representable in locally spatial diamonds was dimmed Rück finite.
Yeah, because for stacks, because of inertia, if there is a...
No, no, I would only want relatively representable maps, okay?
Yeah. So this really is a concept of vertiduality thesis.
Hmm? Yeah, right, so this is basically what...
This is really the concept of vertiduality.
This is vertiduality somehow, right? I mean, this is essentially the definition of these functors. I mean, x and y are the wrong way here, right? Okay. But if f is proper, then you have that rf lower shriek is the same as rf lower star, and so you also get the other one. So also somewhat tautologically, the other one is true. And so it's actually true that if you take the double dual of rf lower star, then it's the dual of rf lower shriek, the dual, which is the double rf lower star of the double dual.
And if lower shriek and upper star, you can do this upper shriek.
Yeah. And so if f is cohomologically smooth, then rf upper shriek is rf upper star tensor the dual. And so, OK, this locally constant sheaf of rank 1 can somehow be, I mean, it commutes with everything tensoring with it. And so, again, you also get the other one that f upper star of the dual is rf upper shriek of the dual. And so, in total, you get that f upper star of the double dual is the dual of rf upper shriek is the double dual of f upper star. And so because you can pull the double dual through the functor, it means that this kind of condition also can be pulled through the functor. Okay. So this is essentially formal.
Why did you say the sum work? Where's the work?
I didn't quite say what kind of stability you need. The little bit of work is related to the fact that the heck, after you push forward the Hecker correspondence, you actually get a sheaf on bungee times the curve. And you actually need to get rid of the curve factor. You still need this reflexive eft after you pull back to a point on the curve. And I will say what I use for this later, but. And also, you need to know that you can restrict to proper smooth Hecker correspondence, because a priori you have these curvous sheaves as kernels. And so, I mean, you have to make this reduction to dimmer zero resolutions and so on. I mean, it's not serious, but a little bit of work. So it's time for a break for 15 minutes. OK, so let's go on. So these reflexive sheaves are nice because you can easily prove stability under the Hecker operators. But on the other hand, it's not so easy to produce any example of a reflexive sheaf, except maybe the constant sheaf.
Some constant sheaf and put it in many translates.
Right. So it's, I mean, the direct sum of the constant sheaf in all different cohomologic degrees is also reflexive if you want. But it's maybe not the.
There's also this question in well, schemes, so the analogous definition, there are serial problems, you don't know.
Right, so yeah, maybe so as Luc de Z brings this up, let me ask the following question, which is. Whose answer is not really important for anything here, but it's maybe an interesting question to think about. So if X is a separated scheme of finite type, maybe over an algebraically closed field K, L is not equal to the characteristic of K. And F is maybe, let's say, in the bounded derived category of the etale side with FL coefficients, then is F reflexive if and only if F is constructible. And so there's certainly the implication that constructible implies reflexive. But it's unclear whether any reflexive sheaf needs to be constructible.
And can one reduce it to the perverse case by some?
Okay. So, no, I don't have place for my main theorem anymore. So I need actually to put an asterisk on the theorem still, because it still depends on one conjecture. I will say what it depends on. It's something that I'm confident can be resolved, but let me be honest. So let's take such a guy. Then F is reflexive if and only if the following condition holds. For all points, so for all elements B and B of G, which give rise to some geometric points, say XB bar mapping to on G. And all integers. If you take this guy and restrict to this geometric point, so then after you pull back to a geometric point, this thing is just a complex of vector spaces. And I look at its I's, of lambda modules, thank you. I take its I square homology group, and then the I have acting on this group GB of QP. And by the general formalism, this is always a smooth representation. but the condition is that it's admissible. No vanishing for large I, just because like the direct sum of lambda in all degrees is reflexive. Right? I mean, maybe in practice you actually want to restrict to some bounded subcategories, but like the theorem is true in this form. So. And there is an addendum which is related to the small work there. And let me just write it this here. And the same holds true for bond G base change to some C, where C is some algebraically closed non-Archimedean field. And if I look at the reflexive subcategory on bond G and pull it back then this is unchanged.
So what do you mean by Banji? Ah.
I mean, this is just the pullback.
Just for perfecto, it's over C.
And then I restrict everything to perfecto, it's over C. Yeah. So I also, for the cotangent complex, I then take the, not the cotangent, for the dualizing complex, I then take the one which comes from the projection 2C, not 2K. So this invariance under change of algebraic Lyapunov space field is necessary to get some applications running, really. But
if a sheaf is a dual of another sheaf, is it then always reflexive?
If a sheaf is a dual of something else, is it reflexive? No, because I mean, for any sheaf, it just might be very big. It might take the dual, then it's even bigger.
I think the dual is always a direct summand of the triple dual, by general. This is
right?
What he was referring to, maybe. So there is one.
No, but if you have something which is, say, countable dimensional, and it's a dual of something, then it must be finite dimensional. So sometimes you can make such arguments. But you need to put some weak. If you have a weak finiteness, like some kind of countable dimensionality, plus it's a dual of something else, and sometimes you can deduce actual finite dimensionality. This will actually come up in an argument. Okay. So right. So a corollary of the theorem. That's the main theorem. Plus a proposition is a finiteness result for the cohomology of Rapoport-Zink spaces. But I don't want to explain this deduction. But I mean, essentially, these hack operators are a way to encode the cohomology of Rapoport-Zink spaces. And then, in particular, you can plug in some admissible representation into this, apply the hack operators, and you get some kind of isotypic part of the cohomology of Rapoport-Zink spaces. And this must still be admissible because the sheaf is still reflexive. So let me start by explaining the proof of the theorem. And so to prove the theorem, you need a very good understanding of the geometry of Banji. So you need very good local charts. Here's the main theorem. Need good local charts. Of Banji. And so there are the usual charts of Banji. So let me explain what the usual charts of Banji are that one would use, which are the ones that are also somehow more directly related to how one views Rapoport-Zink spaces. So the usual charts are as follows. So let me do the simplest case of G is GL2.
But the general theorem is not restricted to G is GL2.
No, the general theorem is general. I mean, for GLN, it's actually a theorem. So this conjecture is something I can prove for GLN. But it's open so far for a general group. But it must be true, this conjecture. The usual charts as follows for, say, GL2. So what you can do is the following. You can you have a map from P1 over this field L, say, and take the associated diamond. And say you mod this out by some k, where k in GL2 QP is open. And GL2 acts in the usual way. So you can map this to bun GL2. What you do here is you, so let me explain this. So this is given by modifying the trivial GL rank 2 bundle. At a point of the curve, the point corresponds to the map to the if you have a map to the etic spectrum of L, this gives you an untilt, and the untilt will automatically give you a section of the Fargues-Fontaine curve. And so if you map to this P1 over L diamond, in particular you map to L spar L diamond, using the given point P1. So if you want to modify a rank 2 bundle at a one point, the simplest kinds of modifications are the ones where you describe a subbundle, which somehow just modifies it by some rank 1 bundle at this point. And this is parameterized by a P1. So it's the usual kind of Bovell-Laszlo type of map. And so this map is smooth, and the total space is also smooth. So this map is smooth, cohomologically smooth.
So it's enough to modify just at one point?
To get all bundles is enough to modify at one point is something that Laurel Fargue proved. But of course, you need to allow more general modifications than just by P1. OK, and so what is the geometry here? So you have this map from P1, diamond mod k. And this maps to, it actually maps to the points isomorphic to either O of a half or O of 1 plus O of minus 1 inside of bun GL2. In particular, there's an open stratum. Which are all the bundles which are isomorphic to O of a half. This corresponds to Drinfeld's upper half space in here. So this corresponds to you take P1 of L and remove P1 of QP, diamond mod K. And then I didn't leave enough space for this. So there is a complementary closed subspace, which is the one where it's isomorphic to. Sorry, what did I write? This doesn't make sense. O of 1 plus O. And this is then given by just the P1 of QP, well, as a mod K. Okay, sorry. I mean, these are stacks, really. But there are some automorphisms. Okay, so locally, if you want to understand those two points, you can think that a smooth chart for this is given by this P1, where this closed subset corresponds to the rational points inside of this guy. And so a consequence of the main theorem, which is also a key step in proving it, is the following result. So if I look at, I have this space which is isomorphic to 0/2. This has an open immersion into the space where it's either 0/2 or 0/1+0. And then there's this closed immersion from the space where it's isomorphic to 0/1+0. And if pi is an admissible representation of d cross, I can build from this a sheaf f pi on point modulo d cross, which is exactly this space. And then there are two ways to extend this to the whole bungee. There's the extension by zero, which obviously has a property that it preserves this condition, that this is satisfied for all b, because for all b other than the one we care about, it's zero anyway. But you can also take the Rj lower star, and so which is a Verdier dual of what you would get if you would have started with a pi dual. So this is again a reflexive sheaf, because the JLOR shriek is reflexive. And so a consequence of being reflexive is that, again, if I restrict to any stratum, in particular to this guy, that it must correspond to an admissible representation of in this case, qp cross times qp cross. So you need to prove a finiteness result, that if you start with something admissible on the open part and then extend by Rj lower star to the whole guy, then what you see at the boundary must still be an admissible representation. Oops. Oops, lost my notes. Right, so, but by smooth base change, one way to compute this is to compute it here. So let's call this j tilde here, and I tilde.
Finiteness condition for the inversion in the smooth bed.
It's more finiteness condition.
So in the smooth bed change, there was no theorem, there was no.
In the smooth base change, no, there is no condition. I mean, so if you have the usual base change theorem for lower shriek, it's always true. So if you always do lower shriek and then upper star, it doesn't matter. And then if you pass to adjoints, you see that if you make lower star and then upper shriek, it always commutes, even without quasi-compacity assumptions. So there's a priori an issue. I mean, there's an important issue that this inclusion here is not quasi-compact. Because, I mean, this is a quasi-compact space, but this is highly non-quasi-compact. And so it's really difficult to compute this functor because, okay, I want to write this down. But smooth base change still holds true in this setup.
Yeah, but in any case, for usual etale cohomologies, they sometimes put this finiteness condition. I don't remember now in the formulation of smooth base change, but probably it holds more generally, as you say, because you can.
I think it just falls by passing two adjoints from the lower Schwieg base change. We can instead compute of the f pi restricted to this, what's called omega 2. Okay. So omega 2. Dive in somewhere. It's p1 minus p1 of qp. So you take f pi on the Strindfeld space. You push forward towards the whole p1, and then restrict to the stratum. I mean, I need that smooth things commute with both the lower star, and this is the argument I would just gave. And then there's the other thing that commutes with I upper star, but that's what I wrote down last time. So it commutes with those functors. But the stalks of this are rather complicated. So stalks are some direct limit over all u in p1l, which contain p1 of qp, and are maybe k invariant. Of the global sections on u of this sheaf. And so you have this p1 somewhere. Then you have inside it this profinite set p1 of qp. And then if you want to compute this r gamma, you somehow need to cover all these guys by little disks. And then take a union as this disk shrink, or a direct limit. And it's pretty hard to control what happens here. No u, right?
No, but u, when you're supposed to make this.
And maybe I'm taking k invariance here. Sorry. What? Minus, sorry. The sections on p minus p1 of qp, yeah. Because otherwise I can't evaluate, yeah. P1 of qp. So u contains p1 of qp, it's an open neighborhood of it. But to evaluate the sheaf, I need to remove p1 of qp again.
U is k invariant, is it quasi compact?
You can assume it's quasi-compact. There's a cofinal subset of such guys which are quasi-compact. But the problem is that if I remove p1 of qp, it's not quasi-compact anymore. So already for a fixed u, computing those global sections is a huge inverse limit because it's inverse limit of the guys of all the cohomology and all the quasi-compact open subsets. And then you need to take a direct limit. So this is impossible to control, essentially.
And the invariance under k is in the derived sense or in the.
Well, k is pro-p, so it doesn't really matter. I mean, say k is sufficiently small for this or something. I mean, I would also. I'm probably computing the invariance of this admissible representation under some compact open subgroup here as well, which depends on the k, choice of k. But if you try to prove by some direct argument that the cohomology of Rapoport-Zink spaces is finite, you run into the same kind of issue that Rapoport-Zink spaces are highly non-quasi-compact, and you somehow have to bound that what happens near the boundary doesn't really contribute much. But that's not so easy to see. I mean, so the moral of what should happen is that if pi is sufficiently ramified, or if pi is ramified, well, there's some given ramification, then on small enough disks, it's somewhat too ramified to really have any cohomology or something like this, but it's hard to formalize.
In the general case, what is p1 is replaced by what?
By some Schubert variety, or the Gemmazou resolution of it, if you want it.
The Schubert variety in which sense?
In the speed around plus Grassmannian. Yeah, so there is a kind of Bourvil-Laszlo uniformization in general, which goes from the from this Biederman plus Grassmannian here to Banji, and you can use that to prove this first theorem about Banji that I stated, that this is a smooth Artin stack of dimension zero. Okay. So you want different charts, and so the key idea is to construct the following charts. And so what I will do is I will fix a point B and B of G, and I want to chart for the set of generalizations of B. So this case would loosely correspond to the case that B corresponds to this O of 1 plus O. And let me assume for simplicity that G is quasi-split. You can make sense of this more generally. Okay, so then, well, if B is basic, there's not really much to do, because then this is actually an open stratum, and it's zero-dimensional. So those guys are easy to understand. So the critical case is where B is not semi-stable. And so if B is not semi-stable, there's actually always a canonical Levy inside of G, for which it is a basic subset. That's the analog of passing to the Hadamard-Zimmer filtration. So there exists a Levy M corresponding to B in G, such that B actually comes from an element a basic element in B of M, and B of M maps to B. And actually, you also get maybe two opposite distinguished parabolics, and I want to fix one of them. You always have a parabolic M contained in P, contained in G. Oh, well, this corresponds to a slope filtration. And let me not try to say if it's the increasing or the decreasing one, because I would screw it up anyway. And because actually, in the functor from isocrystals to vector bundles, there's a sign change in the slope. So it's anyway confusing. Let me give the example of GL2 in a second, and then we'll determine which sign I mean. Okay. So I will look at the following. I will look at, let's call it MB, the following space. It parametrizes P torsors E over Fargues-Fontaine curve, which are, if you push them to the Levy, they are fiber-wise isomorphic to the bundle corresponding to this basic element on the Levy. And so this has a map to Banji, which takes any such E and pushes it out to G. And you also have some torso over this, some GB of QP torso. So actually, the way this works is that this GB of QP is actually the same thing as the form of M corresponding to this BM of QP. So BM is a basic element for M. So this is an inner form of this levy. And so this is just trivializing E times P back to pushed out to M. Let's call this map here pi B.
You said that there are two canonically associated parabolics, this and the opposite one, or?
Right. And I didn't yet tell you which one, and there's only one where this will be a reasonable thing to do. And I will determine this by giving you the picture for GL2 in a second, okay? And actually, just now. So an example for what is a space. So if G is GL2 and B corresponds to O of 1 plus O, then the levy will be GL1 times GL1. And BM always correspond to, well, still somewhat the same thing, except now maybe as a tuple O of 1 comma O. And in this case, what will this MB tilde be? It will parameterize certain P. Well, P will be the Borel here, which one I didn't say. So torsos under the Borel, they're the same thing as the rank 2 vector bundles together with a filtration. So you have such guys. And the second condition determines the filtered pieces of this filtration. And if I'm going here, I'm actually trivializing them. So what I'm doing here is I'm considering the space of all extensions and which parabolic I take is now determined by which way the extension goes. And the extension will be from 0 to E to O, or 1 to O. It wouldn't make sense to do it the other way, because in the other way, all the extensions would be split anyway. So that would not be the good thing to do.
Isn't it a torso under MB?
It's a torso under this, but it's the same thing. OK, so then you can map this to MB, which will be extensions 0 to L, to E to L prime to 0, where these are line bundles. And then instead of saying that they are O or are O of 1, you just say that they are slope 0, respectively 1. OK, and this maps to bund GL2. Just by forgetting about this extension. And the image is again so the image is all the vector bundles which you can write in as an extension of those two guys. So one extension is a trivial extension, O of 1 plus O. And then you can check by the classification of vector bundles that the only non-split extension is all of a half. So in this way, it's S here. Okay? And so the conjecture, which is okay for GLN, I mean, true for GLN, is that this map pi b from mb to bun g is cohomologically smooth. And MB itself is also L-cohomologically smooth, yes.
And this you do by induction, so to speak, already.
I mean, actually, you can check what this actually is doing here. And so you can check that these are actually, I mean, for here, it's just given by a class in H1 of O of minus 1, which is an example of a Banach-Kolmese space. In general, it will, there will, this thing will be some kind of extension of Banach-Kolmese spaces again. So this is these things, this MB tilde is a reasonably explicit guy with an explicit action of this group, and so then this is the quotient. So you can understand this. But actually, the geometry is a little bit funny, so I will maybe end with explaining a little bit about the geometry of this space for this space for GL2. But maybe before doing this, let me make one remark. Why is this true? I mean, this is somehow also true classically. So this statement would have an analog for usual bun G, and in this usual setting, it's also true. And there you can just use the Jacobian criterion to check this. So this is actually an analog of a statement that appears in work of Greenfeld and Simpson that a reduction to a choice of a generic Borel is a smooth thing. Choice of a generic reduction to the Borel. Well, in the case where the parabolic is a Borel, choice of a generic reduction to Borel is smooth. Drinfeld-Simpson. Okay. So let me try to discuss the final 5 minutes, say, a little bit about the geometry of this MB tilde in the GL2 example. Because it's quite a funny space. So as MB tilde is the same thing as a functor as the H1 of S with coefficients in line bundle O minus 1, which contrary to the case of P1 is non-zero. So the analogy you should have in mind is that this is roughly analogous to the adic spectrum of FP power series T 1 over P infinity, or let's say K, because I'm working over K. So it's not itself a diamond. It has some kind of non-analytic point. corresponding to the close point of this, the point t equal to 0 of this kind of formal scheme. But if you look at the structure morphism to the base point, I mean, these are both V-sheaves, then this is representable in diamonds. So whenever you base change to the perfectoid space, say, then this ring will become a diamond, because then it will just become like something like an open unit disk over this space, which is itself a perfectoid space in that case. In this case, it will just be a diamond. Okay, so these are objects that Fargues calls absolute diamonds. So there are some V-sheaves which are not yet diamonds, but whenever you base change to a diamond, they will be a diamond, which is the same thing as saying that the structure morphism to the base is representable in diamonds. So. And so there are two strata so they correspond to just 0 and everything except 0, which are precisely the two strata corresponding to the two possible images inside of bund GL2. I mean, 0 precisely corresponds to the non-split to the split extension. As soon as this extension is non-split, this must be 0/2. And so actually you have an inclusion just of this point 0, which as a function is just the adic spectrum of k. On the other hand, you have some j. And you can check that what this looks like, it's abstractly isomorphic to this Laurent series field, but not quite modulo a pure finite group. Okay, so in this sense, it looks like this example of the power series ring. But then there's something extremely funny happening. Is that what? So this is some kind of punctured open unit disk. And so now you try to move in this punctured unit disk towards the origin. What does it mean? It means, usually it means that the absolute value of t has to go to 0. In this for this space, it means that the absolute value of t has to go to 1. So. So I don't know. I don't know how to draw the space. Like, it's this open unit disk, and then it has one extra point, but it's somehow it's a boundary of this disk.
Is it punctured open unit disk?
It's a punctured open unit. It's this Laurent series T, right? So it's like a punctured open. So whenever you base change this to some non-Archimedean field, then this will be some punctured open unit disk modulus some profinite group, and with one extra point. But this extra point will be somewhere near the boundary of this open unit disk.
And the profile group is acting by like what you explained.
No, actually, I mean, this isomorphism comes from this kind of map to bund GL2. And so this profinite group is actually related to the division algebra. It's maybe the OD cross or something like this. Right, so it's a kind of funny space, but well, it exists, and it somehow behaves like a strictly Henselian space. And so in particular, OK, let me finish with one sentence. If you now want to compute with this chart of some sheaf, then this is now some quasi-compact space. And there are no further other open neighborhoods of this point. So actually, all the subtleties go away. And this thing will just be the cohomology of this MB tilde minus 0 with coefficients in F. And so that's much easier to control. So this is also quasi-compact.
The compactness here, why is it? If it's a, you said it's like an.
Well, that's the funny thing, right? So this is an affinoid-adic space, modulo profinite group. So it's quasi-compact. It's quasi-compact as a, it's just a diamond. But the structure morphism to the point is not quasi-compact. So when you base change, it's not quasi-compact anymore. But just absolutely, it is quasi-compact, and that's critical. So that's.
And the map to MB tilde is quasi-compact, J.
The map is not quasi-compact, but that's not important. OK, I mean, there is some justification behind this, but in the end, this formula is true. And so because here you don't have, this is just quasi-compact, so computing global sections is easy, and there's no more direct limit here, so everything is much easier now. OK, but I'll continue next time.
Question? What is the meaning of the variable here? That you say it's approaching to mass?
Okay, what is this doing? So if you look at this open subset where it is isomorphic to O of a half, then on this part, you can fix the isomorphism to O of a half, which gives you some D cross torsor. And then there are some subtleties. So actually, it's more like an OD cross torsor in the end over it. And but then if you look at such modifications from O of a half to this guy, you can also somehow switch perspective and do it the other way around. And regard, well, then somehow equivalent, this is O of a half. And then you look at all possible ways to write as such an extension. But that's just parameterized by global sections of O of a half, which are not 0. And then maybe there's again some ambiguity, whether I'm here or here. So there's again some profinite groups ambiguity here there. But global sections of this O of a half, they are just given by such an open unit disk, where you need to remove the origin. But this means that this open unit disk came about in such a way that t equal to 0 would correspond to still having O of a half, but this extension collapsing. But that's not what we want to do. That's not the degeneration that happens in this space. In this space, what should happen is that the extension is still valid, but this bundle degenerates. And that happens at the other side.
So the stuff you've just erased must be related to the Jacob and Lenz correspondence somehow, right?
Right. So well, actually, this is supposed to be basically always 0, except for the trivial guy. Because well, in general, Heck operators, they take sheaves somewhere to somewhere else. And for example, they take sheaves which are on the D cross part of Bungee and take it to the DL2QP part of Bungee. And then this is doing some Jacquet-Langlands correspondences. But that's essentially the known phenomenon that in the cohomology of the Lumen-Tate space, you have Jacquet-Langlands correspondences. But then if you go to deeper strata, that's supposed to be some Jacquet functors.
Okay. No further questions. I think the speaker again.